The video you're about to watch is presented to you by God Ministries from one of our spirit schools, ministered by Gustave Leroux. Enjoy and please subscribe. Thank you.
Father, tonight as we stand in you, tonight as we are just reminded of how powerful and how awesome it is for us as sons and daughters to be able to see you, touch you, feel you, to be able to be soaked in you and eat of you and drink of you, and to be continuously reminded by Holy Spirit how deep the Father wants us to go, how much revelation there is, how much understanding He wants to pour into us, how much He wants His sons and His daughters to walk in the fullness of all that which He has destined for us to walk in. Father, I pray that tonight some of that would be attached to us as we bring our spirit beings back into our bodies. Father, I pray that as we begin to walk in our normal day, whether we at work, whether we at home, whether we go into the shopping centers, when we go into Walmart, when we go into our schools with our kids, Father, there will be a tangible glory that will begin to shake the nation. I pray, Father, that we will begin to have an understanding of what you want to bring. Father, we glorify and magnify you. You're a beautiful, majestic God. You know what I want you to do? I want you to just find yourself in the throne room right now. There's not many of us tonight, so let's all go in to the throne room. I'm going to tell you what I see. Now, I don't want to frame anything for you, but the idea of us all going in tonight is that I want you to go sit by Him, sit by His feet as He begins to share a revelation with you, and look at those around you. See if you can see their faces. The idea behind this exercise is the fact that the Father wants this kingdom realm, the kingdom of heaven, for us to become so real that we can see each other there when we all go. So it's not just in your imagination, but as we go in, I want you to start seeing those in the meeting. So right now, when I go into the kingdom of heaven, I usually stand on the outskirts of the throne room, and the marble, white and gray with black marble floor, has a blue flame burning on it. Sometimes it's more intense, sometimes it's less intense. If it's your first time, there might be some fear because it's fire. But in essence, it's really the life of Yahweh that's drawing you to go in. Because as you put your foot on top of the floor, you immediately begin to understand that it will be the first time you ever really breathe. Because you're physically in His presence and your spirit is instantly drawn to Him. So if you're in there and you want to start looking around, see what you see the different things that's there, frame your own things, and remind yourself that what you see there is probably the same as what everyone else sees. I want you to just sit and just let the Father comfort you. Let the Father begin to show you His heart. Remind yourself of the love that the Father has for you. And as you sit in His presence, remind yourself to look in His eyes. Let Him pour into you what you need for tonight. Stay in that presence for a little while. But if it's your first time, let your imagination take you deeper. Let your imagination take you there. And I hate using that because it's the enlightenment, the enlightenment of your understanding. That's what it's all about. It's that revelation that comes to you understanding what your spirit, your soul eye is seeing through what your spirit wants to reveal. So see your spirit man with your soul standing before the Father right now. Declare your love to Him. love you, Lord. We glorify your holy name. Thank you that we can touch you. Thank you that we can see you. There's just multitudes of angels all over the place. If you have your eyes closed and you see flashes of light, different colors coming in and out, you don't know what it is, it's the angelic. Father, tonight we just want to engage with everything you have available. We want to engage with every one of your living creatures, Father, everything you have created for us to engage with. We love you, we praise you, we glorify, magnify you, Lord. Just pour into us revelation, knowledge and understanding as we walk with you tonight, Lord, as we go through the baptism of Holy Spirit and fire. I pray that you will enhance an understanding and a greater dimension of revelation regarding going into you, being soaked in the Holy Spirit to such an extent that everything begins to shift into place. Everything is drawn out of me that's not meant to be there. The fire brings a cleansing and it takes me on to a journey deep into the purity in the heart of Yahweh, where I, as a son and a daughter, is cleansed with dimensional shifts that takes place, with revelations that pours over me, and a dimension of the fullness of your glory, just opening up realms for me to go deeper and deeper into you with. Father, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for who you are, my King. Amen. We have grown very little bit. Well, anyway, last night, how are you guys doing? You all well? Everyone hugging and cuddling quickly? Last night, I at the Spirit School in New Orleans. I had a very exciting encounter, very interesting encounter. I shared it last night, but I think maybe I'll share it again. Just for you guys to begin to understand that the idea that the Father has behind legislation, the idea the Father has behind us as sons and daughters, as Christians, as men and women of God, is that we are more than just to witness to those around us. It's more than just bringing someone to salvation. And it's the shift that we can create in the Spirit. It's that shift that we have the ability to create via the power that the Father has poured into our spirits. So I found my spirit being walking in the earth. As a matter of fact, I was walking in the French quarters, and as I came around a corner, I realized that in front of me would be Bourbon Street. That's Bourbon Street, right?
Yes, it is.
As I walked into Bourbon Street, it was the very beginning of Bourbon Street, I bumped into something, and as I looked up, it was this extremely long, massive snake dragon thing that went literally from the beginning of Bourbon Street right up to the end.
Wow.
And from there, I didn't do anything, I didn't say anything, I just saw it and realized that this was a court case that needed to be handled. And from there, I was shifted into the court of law, where Mike told me something. Now, I've been engaging it for a couple of hours already now, so last night I didn't bring this revelation across, but what Mike basically told me is that there's many riches. There's many of the sons and the daughters of Yahweh's riches buried in this demonic entity, and the power and the ruler that's been in charge over certain areas in the city. And of course, it doesn't just affect the city, it affects the entire state. And it doesn't just affect the entire state, but it literally affects the entire nation, right? Because there's many powers and many principalities, but as for every city and every state and every different country in the world, there's a prince, a roaring angel, there's a power, a principality, a ruler that is meant to be there according to the Father's order, not just the demonic order. That's just logic. If there's powers and principalities and rulers of the darkness of this age, then there has to be powers and principalities of the light of this age. And so as I'm standing there and he's giving me it, so he basically tells me that the sword that's on my back which I never really knew was there, but there was quite an interesting sword on the back of, you know, like stuck in the back of my clothing. And I took it out and I ran from the beginning of the street with my sword in its belly. And I ran all the way up until I got to the very end. And he was freaking out. And out of him came riches, revelations, knowledge, wisdom, scrolls. Literally, if I've ever shared with you about the four rivers that I saw in the kingdom of heaven when I was on the mountain of gold, and in that golden lake there was four rivers, and there was currency and diamonds and rupees and all stones of value. There was books and revelations and scrolls. There was power and lightning and fire. There was a dimension of all of that was inside of this dragon. But it was more like a snakeish dragon. And I couldn't really understand what I was seeing. So in the whole day as I had time, I was just going back in to see what the Father was showing me. But in essence, what the Father was revealing, and it wasn't just me. I just cut his belly open. He wasn't dead yet. The angelic literally came in and destroyed him, nullified him. Now, I've seen a demonic being nullified before out of his own stupidity, but I've never seen the angelic literally nullify a demonic. Now, it was very exciting for me, but I kind of believe that the Father wanted us to understand that this specific entity that was over that region has taken a lot from the saints.
Yeah, yeah.
Has stolen things from the saints and has withheld certain blessings that the Father has wanted to go in. And so I believe that as we begin to war this way, as we begin to understand the authority and power that we carry to go into the spirit realm from the kingdom of heaven side and see the demonic which has never been seen. Because how many of you understand there's been thousands and thousands of people ministering in Bourbon Street?
Yeah, right.
So if the reality behind this is that we've been in the right realm, right, in the spirit, we would have seen it and dealt with it many years ago. But it's because I'm not saying that anyone it's not the wrong way. It's just the old way. We have learned and we have believed that we have to be in the spirit, and that sounds good. So we ask God so that He opens my eyes so I can see in the spirit. And then we start seeing demons. Let me tell you something. When you start seeing demons, you're in the wrong spirit realm.
Wow, right.
Now it sounds really freaky and bad. It's not. It's okay for now, but the idea is that I live and move and have my being in Him. That I always travel up and down, and from up and down, He will send me to and fro.
Yeah.
When He sends me to and fro, I have the ability and the power to deal through the courts with what needs to be dealt with according to a mandate given to me by either one of the seven spirits or being in one of the courts. As Holy Spirit leads me in, or even as Yeshua leads me in. But if I, out of my own sight, go into a place and see demons and deal with them there in the name of Jesus, the idea behind that is a big fat hiding. Do you not understand that?
Hiding?
A smack bottom.
A whipping.
A whipping.
Oh.
Because you come back after... you come back after a warfare like that and you're beaten up.
Yeah.
I mean, it does, maybe not everybody, but I look at some great men that has had deliverance ministries, that's written books, and that's done great, phenomenal things. And then I listen to them share behind the scenes, and they say things like, I have lived in a life of depression.
Right. Wow.
I've suffered with thoughts of suicide all my life. Never written in their books. We don't know that. We don't see that. But at the back scenes, that's what's being said.
Right.
Because the idea has always been up and down. Even in the very beginning, Jacob's ladder was the first sign that we shouldn't be walking to and fro.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not saying you can't walk to and fro, because the seven spirits walk to and fro, seeking sons and daughters. But in the same breath, Satan walks to and fro, seeking who he may devour. So if he may devour some, it means that there's some in his domain that shouldn't be there.
Yeah.
It's the ecclesia walking to and fro in a realm that they're not supposed to be in.
Wow.
Now I remind you, although we're not supposed to be in that realm, in the same breath, I have authority over all that's given to me.
Yeah.
So in essence, the enemy has no right to that realm, but in the same breath, I have to remind myself that if I am placed in that realm via the Father and the Spirit, then I have authority. But if I'm there on my own account, then I'll get beaten up. Yes, I have the name of Jesus, and yes, I can use it with power, but in essence, he's just going to come beat me up again because I open doors for the demonic to hover around me.
Wow.
Are you guys okay what I'm saying here?
So
I really believe that this is a time where the Father is about to bring a great change to the nation.
Yes.
Now I say these things, but I want to remind you, as I believe by faith that I have slain 2 giants and 4 dragons over the last 2 years. Now, I'm not saying that I'm the only one, because I remember going into Baton Rouge the other day, and there was Prince of Roaring Angel that I haven't met yet, and I realized that some of the sons of God have been doing some things. And a matter of fact, when there was the flooding in Baton Rouge, and yeah, I was hovering over that region, over that city in the spirit, and I wasn't the only one there.
Oh, wow.
There was other men and women doing the exact same thing in the spirit. So that was really exciting. And so I know for a fact that there's other men and women in this nation doing the exact same thing. Now, as much as we don't want to believe it, there's thousands and thousands of demonic entities out there that's not being seen by the sons and daughters of the Most High.
Yeah.
Because if I go into this realm, into the kingdom of earth, into the realm where Satan walks to and fro, if I go there without an assignment, without the right rule according to what the Father has destined, and I just go in there to see what I see, I'm going to see demonic entities and I'm going to see powers, but I'm not going to see the principalities ruling over the regions. So I can't pull it out by its roots. And I remind you that they're always hidden. But once a son or a daughter steps and lives in the Spirit like Yeshua did, you get to see what's never been seen. That's why we can deal with them at a level that they don't know how to handle.
Right.
Okay, exciting, isn't it?
Yeah, that's good.
I love the baptism. So tonight we're doing the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire. So it's being baptized in the Holy Spirit, but in the same breath, it's not so much being baptized in the Holy Spirit as it is being baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire. Okay, we'll explain it now. It's the preparation for revival and refreshing.
Amen.
Those two together is almost like the breath of Yahweh you can't go without.
Yeah.
Because if I'm constantly baptized in the Holy Spirit, now I'm not talking about speaking in tongues. I'm talking about soaking on Him, eating of Him, drinking of Him. I'm talking about completely and utterly being in Him to such an extent that whatever comes out of me is Him. It's like I said last week, He squeezes me and all that comes out of me is Holy Spirit. But because Holy Spirit is the consummation of covenant, the consummation of encouragement, that dimension of the Father that's literally the fire burning in the saints. It also brings me to a place of deep, deep intimacy and deep, deep holiness and purity.
Amen.
I believe that's a desire the Father has for the body of Christ.
Yes.
In Luke 3:16 it says, John answered them by saying, I baptize you with water, but he who is mightier than I is coming. His steps whose sandals I'm not worthy to unfast. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. But how many of you understand that if I am baptized with the Holy Spirit, the evidence in Acts 10:45, it says that the evidence of being baptized with the Holy Spirit is speaking in other tongues. Now I want to just throw something at you. Speaking in other tongues is, as we obviously hear it, comes out as a sound. Ramoye, Shebra, Kosaki, Indrinesta. It doesn't particularly sound like any word we know in the natural. It doesn't sound like anything I could understand. But I want to tell you that it's not a language per se. It's a frequency. Ra. If you can hear it in the spirit, the way I say it, now, it's no specific type of a pronunciation when it comes to your tongues, but it creates a frequency that's released in you, comes out of you, goes into the spiritual atmosphere, goes into the natural atmosphere, and according to the word, it creates encouragement, it brings mysteries and secrets, and reveals great revelation.
Amen.
It's a dimension of you that brings that comes out of you and into you that grows you and grows that which you are meant to be at all at the same time.
That's good.
It's a different type of fire.
Yeah.
So it's almost the flame you need to get the fire burning as big as what it should be.
Yes.
That's why Paul said, made statements like, I pray in tongues more than all of you.
Right.
And if you look at the miracles and the things, you know, you don't that often, although there's some, you don't hear Paul saying that he healed this one and healed that one and raised this one from the dead and did that. If you listen to the miracles that he walked in, it was a completely different dimension. You know, he would be praying and all of a sudden he disappears and he's at someone's house. Or the gates of the prison shakes and opens up and he walks out. You know, he's bitten by a snake and nothing happens. He's shipwrecked and he's in the waters for 24 hours. How many of you understand? Have you ever seen the movie Deep Oceans? Is it Deep Oceans or Ocean Deep? Where the two divers go with a group and they get left behind. And the entire movie is just about these two divers in the middle of the ocean dying.
Open waters.
Wow. They're just in the water 24 hours. And they actually say it's impossible to make it. Because the dehydration, you can't drink the water, the excessive amount of salt in the water, the fish always, they will be bickering when they eat you, there will be always something, you won't make it.
Yeah.
And that's happened to him twice.
What?
It's not, you know, it's like me phoning my mom saying, Mom, I was in a plane crash yesterday, I'm the only survivor, I just want to tell you that I'm okay. What's the chances of that happening?
Yeah. Yeah.
Then a week later, I'll phone my mom again, Mom, it happened again, a different plane this time. Believe it or not, and again, I'm the only survivor. Everyone else is dead. I just want to tell you that I'm okay.
Wow.
A supernatural dimension of what the Father has released over Paul, I believe, is because of the dimension that he walked in this baptism.
Wow.
It's a baptism that brings you to a place of complete and utter holiness, but not holiness in the sense of what we perceive of being sin or sinlessness. Because we have an understanding because of our religious perception regarding sinlessness. It's like, oh, I don't get angry, I don't swear, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't sleep around, I don't watch pornography, I don't do this, I don't do that. So there's this big doo-doo list in our perception of that. Those things are sin. But how many of you understand, according to the Father, those things are not sin. Although it is sin, but those things are not what he looks at. He looks at the heart. So when he looks at your heart and there's a blackness in your heart, that's what he sees as sin. So in essence, it's everything and anything you do in your life outside of faith.
Right.
So when this baptism comes, it literally burns and sears the heart of man to a dimension of purity that cannot be given in any other way, fashion, or form. Because our perception of holiness will begin to fade away as it's no longer through works and the do-do list. Is that, that's why Joshua, the high priest, would stand in front of the Father, and I said this before, he's the holiest man in the entire nation. Right? I mean, if he wasn't, and he walks into the Holy of Holies, how many of you understand what happens?
God.
He drops dead, literally, dead ex-priest. Then they have to pull his leg, they pull him with a rope that was tied around his leg.
Right.
Because the bells stop belling. And that's kind of freaky. So then they know that was sin. but it didn't happen to him. But yet the Father looked at that holy man and said, take off his garments, he's filthy. Why? Because of his heart.
Wow.
So this baptism is that which purifies the heart. But it's that soaking in Holy Spirit that brings it. That's why Jesus got all excited when he said to his disciples, no, you don't understand. I have to send your Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is going to show and teach you everything you need to know about me. Mm-hmm. And once you know and you've been taught everything about me, you'll know the Father because I brought only that which I saw the Father do. So everything you saw in me was the Father's heart.
That's good.
You guys okay?
Yeah. That's good.
Okay, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is an enduring of power and of the fire that burns and releases the power. The idea behind the soaking in the Holy Spirit, now, I don't know if you've ever seen the Holy Spirit. When I ask people that question, they look at me with a tone in their voice like you kind of do now. But I remind you that the Holy Spirit is much a person as what Jesus is. The Holy Spirit is as much a person as what the Father is. As a matter of fact, the idea behind engaging with the Holy Spirit is that you sit with Him and allow Him to talk to you and meditate with you and lift you up and shift you and create revelation in you and open you up, because that's what He does. Now, I don't always explain to people what I see, because I don't think it really matters what I see, because I don't want to frame anything for you. I want you to kind of frame it for yourself. But I look at myself in the Spirit and what I look like, and I look at Holy Spirit, and there's this resemblance. He kind of looks like me in the Spirit.
Wow.
But I don't look like me in the Spirit. I look like Him in the Spirit. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So there's an idea behind just releasing that intimacy into the Holy Spirit that brings great revelation of power and fire. Because the idea of the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire is that those two cannot be separated. I can be baptized in the Holy Spirit, but when I'm baptized with the Holy Spirit, it's a different dimension. We're going to do the baptism into the Holy Spirit next week, but the baptism of the Holy Spirit and fire is a different thing. So the idea of being baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire is that I literally have that which is already given to me multiplied over me as I engage and go deeper. Okay, there's no power. There is no power flow if we sin, and so the fire burns, purifies us, and changes our nature. I remind you that the Father's desire for us is to completely and utterly walk the earth pure and set apart. Now, again, I'm not talking about the do-do list.
Right.
Because although a lot of the stuff we do is sin, everything we do is not sin. But in the same breath, in the Hebrew culture, everything is sin. Do you guys know that?
Yeah.
Everything is sin unless it's been restored. But in the same breath, it's all been restored through the blood of Yeshua. But the sons and the daughters of the Most High, the Ecclesia, hasn't bring restoration with it yet. Because we have to legislate restoration in the earth through the blood of Yeshua. Okay, so the idea of the fire is it's not just like the river of fire. Like there's a river of fire, there's a river of glory, there's a river of life. But in the kingdom of heaven, there's a river of fire as well. And this river of fire is very much the same as this baptism. The idea for me is to continuously find myself in this fire. Now, I've said this before, and maybe some of you have seen it. Over the last couple of years, there's been a seraphim in and out of the nation, and they were creating a river through the entire earth, a flowing river of fire burning for the saints to go into. Because the Father longs for a bride that is pure and white as snow. And yes, the blood brings that, but our actions and our choices has to reflect that holiness. And so as the sons and the daughters of today step into the Spirit and we begin to see what is available for us and the dimension of purity the Father wants us to walk in, we will literally soak in the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Now the river of fire is in the earth, because how many of you are reminded that Holy Spirit was sent into the earth? So we have the Old Testament where the Father was actively involved in the lives of the people. We've got the New Testament where Jesus was actively involved in the lives of the people. And then, of course, today we have the Holy Spirit that's actively involved in the lives of the people.
Right.
So the river's in the earth because the river represents Holy Spirit and the fact that we have to be baptized into Him because He represents the fire of purity.
Good.
Are you guys okay?
Yeah.
As we engage with all that which the Father has made available, we'll see that a lot and many of the angelic beings that we can engage with is consumed with fire. For example, I think it's in Hebrews 1:7, it says, referring to the angels, he says, God who makes his angels spirits and ministering spirits, servants, flames of fire.
Right.
then you'll quickly begin to understand that there's so many different types of angels, and they all have specific tasks, and all that it adds up to is they need to propel you into a greater dimension of holiness, greater dimension of purity, greater dimension of revelation, deeper and deeper into intimacy with the Father. And so as we begin to engage, and as we begin to see that this baptism is not just a baptism per se, it opens your eyes, it reflects you deeper into the Spirit, it purifies you, it shakes all that which is not meant to be on you off.
Amen.
And of course, in Hebrews 12 it says, "For our God is indeed a consuming fire." And of course, if we think about it logically, fire is there to purify that which is unpure. But I come from a city, actually the town that I was born in, Randfontein, and then of course western area where my family stayed. And you have Carltonville, Kloof, Glen Harvey, Fenton's Post, all these little areas, all mining towns where they mine for gold. And so every school year we would go on a trip to one of these mines to see how they do the making of gold. And let me tell you, it is quite a process. And when you see what it looks like when it comes out of the ground, you think, really? Tons and tons and tons of what? Black rock.
Wow.
It's then compressed and burned at a level of heat that you can't even come near to get a block of gold. As a matter of fact, it's about this size, eh?
Yeah.
The average block of gold looks like this.
Wow.
And then the guy makes a statement, and he says, if you can lift this block of gold with your one hand, you can have it.
Really?
Not, he's just joking. It's worth lots and lots of money. But the process of purifying gold is quite intense. So I believe that the purification, and as much as we've probably gone through this fire in our lives as saints already, the Father, because of revelation and because of the now revelation of this, we're going to go through it at another level. Because I always want to say this, as the Word has milk, meat, and mystery in every dimension of it. For example, the written has those three. The spoken has those three. The living has those three. Then every level of my life has those three. So when I'm just born again, I go through a dimension of the milk, I go through a dimension of the meat, and I go through a dimension of the mystery. And then I go to the next level. And so every level I'm at, I have that dimension of those three aspects changing and shifting in me. So the level that we're at today, we are leaders and men and women in ministry, and we are apostles and prophets and legislators in the kingdom, our level of purity has to shift into a whole new place. So I believe that this process the Father takes us through as we go through this baptism becomes more intense. You know, where I maybe 10 years ago could get away with things that I can't even think of today. But when I got away with it then, as bad as what it wasn't that bad because of the level that I was at. But as you shift deeper and you go higher and you go wider into Him, you have so much more responsibility in the kingdom that what you do has a greater effect. So the dimension and level of purity has to be so much higher.
Yeah.
No pressure. Right? Thank you, Lord. And our God's a consuming fire. But in the same breath, that's why we have the availability to go into the throne. Because I can't clean myself.
Yeah.
I can't purify myself. But I can present myself to Yeshua, and He will present me to the Father as a living sacrifice.
That's good.
Fire goes before Him and burns up His adversaries around about. Being baptized in the inside of the Holy Spirit will quickly bring you to an understanding that you do not have to fight your battles. It's a revelation that we've always had, we just never understood. I do not have to bind and rebuke Satan. I can. I'm not saying that I can't, because we have done it for such a long time. And we've had some great success. You know, with that revelation, we have raised three people in our ministry from the dead.
Wow.
And we've seen some great healings with that method. But there was no legal grounds on which we dealt with that problem.
Don't forget the cat.
And the cat. We raised the cat from the dead too. Reuben.
Don't forget the cat.
Reuben was then poisoned and survived, and then was ran over and survived.
Oh, no way. We had 9 lives.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And of course, it was very interesting because we raised him from the dead at birth. You know, his mother already pushed him aside. He was ice cold. Claire was insisting that the Lord told her that all three will be alive. And so she told me and Neil, a guy that was staying with us, to pray for the cat. And I put my two fingers on his chest and I remember my heart. And it was the first time my heart spoke.
Oh, wow.
My spirit. And it said, I believe. As I said, come, command life to return in the name of Jesus. My heart spoke and said, I believe. And immediately the cat started moving. Then my 2-year-old boy, which is now my 11-year-old, ran to the room and came back and said, well, I was three, eh? And he said, his name is Reuben. I don't know where he ever got that name from, but it means well-answered prayer, right?
Yeah, answered prayer.
Answered prayer.
Wow.
Then of course I said to the Lord, now why would you do something like that? You know, like seriously, there's other people dying out there and you're raising a cat from the dead. And they said, no, that wasn't the point of the exercise. He said, my princess asked me.
That's awesome.
You know, but there's a better method. So the idea of being in the Holy Spirit and baptized in His fire is the fact that He will work all things out for you as you're clothed in Him.
Amen.
Which means the works I used to do has nothing to do with the kingdom, because the kingdom is not what you do. The kingdom of heaven is not what I do. The kingdom of earth is not what I do. The kingdom of God is not what I do. It's who I am. So it's a dimension of operation that I have to run in. And this baptism brings me to that understanding, brings me to that place where He says, I will fight your battles. But in the same breath, He's the king. And how many of you understand the king doesn't always fight in the war?
Right.
He sends his warriors out. He's got other things to do. Now sometimes he does, because Yeshua is on his white horse with blood dropping from his sword. So yes, he's been in the war. And he's not afraid of it. But he sends out the angelic. He's got millions and millions and millions of them ready to work for you. Ready to destroy the works of the enemy as they come towards you. All right? And of course, as I'm baptized in Holy Spirit, the idea behind the Holy Spirit is the fact that it means the ecstatic state prophecy.
Wow.
And in the same breath, it's also your lance. You know what a lance is?
Lance.
Lance. It's your lance. Your lance. Okay, it's your spear. Do we all understand that?
Yeah.
And the Bible talks about it in Ephesians 6 where it says, and never cease to pray. Right now, that is the dimension where I have an understanding that the Father, as I'm baptized in the Holy Spirit, have the ability to see the enemy come before he gets to me. So I'm not constantly under attack, because the enemy doesn't have to beat me up before I see him. I have the ability to live in my tomorrow, so I know every step he's going to take before it's been made. That's why I have to continuously be aware of the fact that I'm in the Holy Spirit, and He is the Spirit of prophecy.
Amen. That's good.
Exciting, isn't it?
Yeah.
The light of Israel shall become the fire, and His Holy One a flame, and it will burn and devour thorns and briars in one day. See, there's a dimension of the burning ones that the Father wants to bring to light.
Yes.
There's a dimension of who we are as the army of Joel. There's a dimension of who we are as the ones clothed in light. I always want to say that the light, when the Father talks about light, and when we talk about light, we always, in our subconscious, we think that it's something you switched on, right? Because that's all we can perceive. But if you look at the sun, it is the light of the earth, am I right? And if you get a little bit closer to the sun, what is it?
Fire.
It's fire. If I'm clothed in the light of Yahweh, it literally tells me that I'm clothed in the fire. I'm clothed in the fullness of the fire. And you know, we are so freaked out by fire because we always think of hell. But you know, if you think about the fire of hell, I think it's mentioned a couple of times in the Bible. But the fire of God, and that is a consuming fire that is represented in this ball of fire. As a matter of fact, if I go to the kingdom of heaven, my transportation is a ball of fire in Him. And they say, and my name is Son of Fire.
Yeah. Wow.
There's just so much to do with fire in the kingdom of heaven, that the fire that is burning in hell really doesn't represent anything per se.
Yeah.
But I have to have an understand that the Father wants me to see what I am in Him and run with the fullness of that fire that not just brings purity, but it shows and reflects the fullness of the power of Yahweh in the sons and the daughters as we run the earth. In Isaiah 31, verse 9, it says the Lord, whose fire is in Zion and His furnace in Jerusalem. Now, I love Joel because it represents a dimension of God's army that we need to step into today. And verse 2 and 3 says, a fire devour before them, and behind them a flame burns. The land is as the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yes, and nothing shall escape them. What I love about that scripture, for me, it basically tells and reminds me that the Father is my fire, and because I'm in Him, I am constantly burning. Now, I remind you that I could choose to step out of Him. I can choose to step out of His glory. I can choose to step out of the kingdom of heaven, operate in the flesh, in the earth, where Satan is lurking, seeking who he may devour, find me and kill, steal, and destroy, because it's all he knows. Or I can stay in the fire. I can stay in the light. I can stay in the fullness of this flame that He has given me, baptized me into, and constantly have everything that comes against me burn and seared.
Yeah.
And I'm reminded of the mobile court, and I'm reminded of His judgment. Because while I'm in Him, and He's my covering, and His blood is over me, and He's my head, His judgment over me is life. His judgment over me propels me and lifts me up. But that same judgment destroys and nullifies and sears and burns the enemy and the works of anything outside of that covering.
That's good.
So in essence, His blood, His fire is my judgment. Behold, I sent my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come in His temple, even the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, He is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of His coming, and who can stand in His appears? For He is like the refiner's fire, and like launderer's soap. So He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. He will purify sons of Levi, the priest, me and you, and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer the Lord an offering in righteousness. Mm. See, it's always been the Father's desire for us as priests. Now, I remind you, this is the order of Melchizedek. Who calls someone Melchizedek? Let's be honest. Just think of something else to call this guy, because
he knows a heavenly being. He has a name like that.
Yeah, I must be. It's just too much for me to handle. I just call him
Ezekiel.
Mal.
Kezi.
You know, I mean, hope you don't mind, but you know, no one pronounces his name right. Melchizedek. I don't know. Anyway, how do you guys say it?
Melchizedek.
Okay. I don't know. But anyway, this guy, he's got an order in the kingdom of heaven. We've discussed this before, and it's being a king, it's being a son, being a king, being a priest, being an oracle, being a legislator. It's similar to what we have in the earth as the fivefold, the evangelist, the pastor, the teacher, the prophet, and the apostle. But that's why the Bible tells us that the fivefold in the earth will pass away, but the Melchizedek order will never pass away. Now, there's a greater dimension of that, because for every order, there's an order. You guys know that, right?
Yes.
So we will all continuously grow, because if I am in the fivefold in the earth, my growth is into the Melchizedek order in the kingdom of heaven, because the idea is to continuously grow. As a matter of fact, if I look at the multitude of Yahweh in the earth, If I look at the multitude of Yahweh anywhere I go at any given time, it is beyond what I can fathom or understand. Matter of fact, if I begin to understand the knowledge and the revelation that we have today as the church, we are probably likely not even touching the hem of his garment yet. So there's just so much growth left that I can imagine that there's levels upon levels upon levels upon levels and dimensions and realms that we need to step into and go into that he wants to reveal to us. But he has to wait until we're ready for the truth, because it's that dimension of truth that will set us free at the level that we act.
Wow,
yeah. So we have to just constantly push in and go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. Malachi said, "Behold, I sent my messenger, and he will prepare the way before you." In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." I really believe that the Father wants to place mantles unto his sons and daughters. And as we go through this baptism of fire, now I'm not saying that I am in any way, fashion, or form at a level any higher than anyone in this room. But what I am saying is I believe that I have revelation regarding these baptisms, and I've walked through them in my life many, many, many times over. Now, I've only been walking in all of this for 5 years. But I know that doesn't say much, right? But in the same breath, it's something that if you speak to my wife, I've been pursuing ever since I first got hold of it. I've been waking up, ever since I got hold of this revelation, I started waking up at 5 in the morning, and I haven't stopped yet. It's been 5 years. Just so that I can have a dimension of understanding and receive revelation and endure and go in and in and in. Because when my kids wake up, the day shifts. And everything changes. I can still engage because the Father has taught me. But the idea is that I get myself into a place, into a habit where I can engage as much as I possibly can, so that this stuff can become real to me. And in this engagement, in this walking, in this baptism, a mantle of the saints of old is placed over and onto God's sons. Because not everybody gets the same mantle. I've got 3 mantles, that's now 1. As a matter of fact, I might share this with you. I was given a mantle called love, which I wasn't very impressed with. I shared this with you before, you know. Let's be honest now, show me something else, Lord. But anyway, I got the revelation of it, and I really enjoyed it. And then about 2 months ago, I was given one mantle with 2 different dimensions on it, and it was intimacy and fire. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, anything fire I want, because I believe that's what the Father's place on my life. And so I said, okay, I'll take it. But the Lord then said to me, okay, but you have to trade with something of great value. Now I'm thinking, my wife? It's like, no. I'm just joking, baby. Now, I immediately knew what he wanted. I immediately knew that he wanted me to trade the mantle of love for the mantle of fire and intimacy. Now, I've been walking the road with him for the last, I would say, 6 to 8 months, where he came to me and said, I'm going to teach you how to love me more. That's the dimension of intimacy. And in this 6 or these 8 months, I got my new name. So it's already fire and intimacy that he was been working on. And when he came with a mantle, I knew that of great value to me would be the mantle of love. Yeah. I didn't want to do it because I know the value of it now.
Yeah.
But I just, by faith, I said, okay, and I took it off in the spirit and I gave it to him at the sea of glass. And as I did that, it literally, like the staffs of Moses and the other guys, it all became one staff. Uh-huh. My cloak of love went into the other cloak and made one big cloak that was then placed on my shoulders. And I believe that as we engage this, there's cloaks in the spirit. Now, I want to also be, let's just throw it out there, I cannot just go hand out cloaks.
Right.
As a matter of fact, we can't just hand out cloaks.
Yeah.
It just doesn't work like that. It's something that has to come either from a saint of old, because you can't get a cloak unless the person died.
Yeah.
Unless the person is not alive anymore. Now, I don't know whose cloaks I have, because that wasn't my engagement. It wasn't given to me by man. It was given to me through Yeshua as I engaged with him. But I do believe that there's a mantle in the earth like Elijah's mantle. That, how many of you understand, has a spiritual value, so there's more of one, more than one of them. Like David, like Moses. Now you think to yourself, who wants Moses' mantle? We just think like that because, you know, he sinned so badly and he couldn't enter into the promised land. But we forgot that he spent 80 days literally face to face with Yahweh, almost beyond what we can fathom. Then he came back and wrote the 5 books of the Bible to such detail that we can't even understand where he got it from. He even wrote of his own death. As a matter of fact, not even that, that's amazing. But then you look at him and say, it's the only body that's ever been fought for. So he said, okay, you know, Lord, I made a big mistake and I get to die, thank you, but can I please take my body into heaven? How many of you understand? You die and then your body rots in the earth.
Yeah.
Then you get a glorified body when you go into the heavens. Your physical body doesn't go with you unless you're Enoch or Elijah.
Right.
Right, so who was at the Mount of Transfiguration? Moses and Elijah.
Yeah.
So he got his body into the heavens.
There
was a dimension of intimacy that he had with the Father that we can't fathom. It goes beyond what we read in the Bible.
Yeah.
And I believe that these mantles are available as we get soaked in the baptism of fire in the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
It opens up dimensions to it. Now, of course, I've always loved the Pentecost fire. And I just want to say this again. That which happened in Pentecost was a reflection of what happened to the Israelites when Moses came down the mountain. It was the marriage ketubah that the Father gave. We did this in the marriage the marriage covenant, the cloud of Moses, the baptism into the glory. Remember? You got to look at me with a tone of voice. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be a witness to me. When that day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord. Like I say, that wasn't a Honda. In one place, and suddenly there came a sound of heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Then like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks. I didn't just read that and get drunk. Because I believe this is a measure given. We today have the fullness of that measure.
Wow.
And we need to engage it as much as possible. Because if you begin to have revelation, now this could be the milk if you read it as is. But in that scripture is the meat and the mystery. In that scripture, you have to literally go back to the first mention, because there's a law of first mention. You guys know about the law of first mention. You always want to go back into the Old Testament. When you read something interesting in the New and you don't exactly know what it stands for, what the purpose of it, you want to go back to the first mention, where it was first mentioned. And the tongues of fire coming out, it all represents that which happened on the mountain as Moses came down with the Ten Commandments. That same place where the Father said, will you marry me? I present this contract to you. What do you give me back? And they were freaked out and ran away and said, Moses, you deal with this dude. He's going to kill us. But at this day, at Pentecost, all they could say is yes. Yes, because they were open and ready and they wanted everything that was available. The mindset that slavery was gone. Matter of fact, I believe it was just open and available for all, whether Israelite or not.
Wow.
Right?
That's right.
And I believe the Father wants us to continually engage in that fire. Because as I am full with Holy Spirit, it's a fire that comes on and over me that reflects a covenant of intimacy. That reflects a covenant of deep, deep revelation the Father wants to pour over his sons and daughters. It's the ecclesia, covenant Holy Spirit, and in his fire, walking the earth. That's where Moses come down the mountain and there's fire in his eyes. There's lightning bolts and thunder coming out of him. His face is changing, lion, ox, eagle, man. Literally, he takes the golden ox, or was it a little cow? Same thing, right?
Yeah.
And he smashes it into powder. You got to understand that's impossible.
Yeah, it is.
For gold to turn to powder, it has to burn at an excessive excessive heat. He was baptized in the fire. Soaked in the fire. And the Father wants us to walk in that glory, in that fullness. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. The idea behind all that the Father wants, as I soak myself in Holy Spirit, I come to a place of submission. My faith in Christ, in the Father, and Yahweh, and Holy Spirit is all about submission. Now, my understanding of submission is that I hold you to such an extent that you cannot move. How many of you understand? That is not what the Father is talking about. Because a submission in relationship is different. It's gentle and soft. The Father's heart is not to control you.
Yeah, that's right.
The Father's heart is to have you in Him, and you do what you do because what you do is His perfect will. What you say because it's His perfect will.
Yes.
Where you go to because it's His perfect will. That's submission. It's being in Him and one with Him to that extent. That's why walking in the Spirit is so important, because I can be one with Him in spirit. And from there it reflects into my soul, into my body. As I submit to Him, I walk in a greater dimension of prayer. Now I will say this again, prayer is not going on your knees with your hands together. Prayer is a lifestyle. Matter of fact, I almost want to say I don't like the word prayer because it's been abused.
Yeah.
Now, let's just call it talk. Because that's what He wants. He wants His people to talk to Him at a new dimension, a new level. Deeper, deeper, deeper. Not just about my sins and my needs. Let's have a conversation about the nation. Let's have a conversation about all that which I'm seeing in the kingdom of heaven, so I can have an understanding of what sight's coming to me. There's a deeper approach, a greater intimacy, a personal relationship that goes beyond what I'm used to, because that what I'm used to is not good enough for today.
That's right.
What I had yesterday, I can't have today. If I have the same yesterday than what I have today, I'm backsliding. That's why sometimes I say, well, what I preached a week ago, I might not believe today. That doesn't say much for what I preach, but that's the truth, because it's constantly changing and constantly growing in revelation. And I remind you, I say this all the time, I remind you, but never mind. This baptism leads me to a repentance of sin, the change of the way I think, the change of that which I believe is right. Because there's certain things we do because that's what we were taught.
That's right.
So it might not be sin, but it's not propelling me deeper into Him.
Yes.
It's not it's not having me going deeper into Him, actually keeping me away from Him.
That's good.
So He'll just begin to show us what needs to change in my way of thinking. You know, getting rid of offenses, unforgiveness, bitterness, all these things that can so easily hold me back, that I don't always know it's sin or think that it's sin. Right?
Yeah.
Let's stand. Mm-hmm.
That's good. Wow.
Like I said in the beginning, I really enjoy the baptisms. You know, it's not really something that's great revelation, because we've walked through it, we've heard it so many times before. I believe it's the foundations of our faith. You know, but I know that also in the same breath of the Father, through the ability to go into the Spirit because of His blood and the torn veil, and having the ability to see it through my spirit eyes, and then reflecting that which I see into my soul and into my body, can affect my body and my soul in a whole new way. So what I urge you to do in the week is to engage this baptism, to engage the fire that's already in the earth. And if you don't see it, ask the Father to show you. And I remind you that it's the enlightenment of your understanding that brings you this revelation. It's the eyes of your soul that sees through what your spirit's doing. So engage it as much as you can. Engage with the seven spirits. Engage with the angels. And let them bring revelation regarding all these things that's taking place. And if you still struggle with this and you want to talk to me, I'm on Facebook. You can email me. Even on our website, contact us. You can email us, or I'll email you back. You can contact me on Facebook, speak to me there. Whatever you feel you need to do to get greater understanding of what I'm teaching, please feel free to speak to me or to my wife, or whichever you feel more comfortable with. If I don't have answers, we'll think of something that sounds good. We'll get someone else to answer it for us. But I've got so many questions, but I just don't have enough people. I don't really know a lot of people that can give me answers. And the ones I do know, I can't get to.
Yeah.
So I really have to rely on what the Father's bringing to my spirit, what I study in the Word, what I meditate on, what the Holy Spirit brings, emails I'm waiting for that's not returned. So, and I understand I'm not fighting about it. I'm just saying we need explanations for a lot of things that's happening. You know, so if you have questions, I might just be able to answer it, but I might not.
Yeah.
But if I can't, we can find an answer for you.
Right.
Okay, yeah. Let's pray. Father, we just want to activate this in the name of Yeshua. We want to thank you for your power and your glory. Holy Spirit, we want to thank you that we can engage with you. Thank you for your baptisms. Thank you that we can climb into you. And inside of you is a burning fire, a flame set alight for the sons and daughters to walk in, that which literally sears the purity, sears our heart into a dimension of purity that we cannot walk in by doing good works, Father. So I ask you right now that you will open up the eyes of your saints, Father. You will open us up to such an extent that we will walk in a greater dimension of revelation and insight. Tonight I ask, Father, that as we are baptized in the Holy Spirit, that understanding of our tongues, that understanding of walking in the Spirit, seeing in the Spirit, having revelation in the Spirit, and reflecting those revelations into my soul and my body, affects my soul, so that I can walk the fullness of what you've called me to be in, Lord. I pray that you will awaken the bride to all of these things, Father. Awaken the bride to the understanding and the knowledge of what we need to walk in, Father. Yes, the old is powerful. The old is great. And we want to hold on to it. It doesn't have to let go. I had to take of what was precious to me, and I had to trade for something new, and I didn't want to do it. But when I did it, it all became one. It became more powerful, and it changed. And I believe that's what the Father wants to do with the new and the old. He wants us to take the old and trade it into the new, because it might not fall away like we think it will. It might just bring it to a whole new dimension. So Father, as we just let go of that which we hold on to, I pray that you will begin to pour the new into the ecclesia, the new into the fullness of the church. And as we start walking in the power and the manifestation of what you're teaching us, let the world see the glory, and let the fullness come to the earth as we legislate the kingdom of heaven into the earth. Father, we love you. We praise you. In the name of Yeshua. Amen.